Coming up next, building this model here. Well, hey guys, and welcome back to another Interstellar Modeler. Before I get started, I thought I'd let you know that I'm using a new camera here now. This is a Sony Alpha 6400. This replaces the old Canon camcorder I was using. That one finally gave out. As much as I enjoyed using it, it was nice and portable and lightweight. It really did start to become very glitchy, and so I replaced it with this camera, which came recommended by my friend Kenny Conklin from Hobby Link International. So thank you, Kenny, for this great recommendation. It's a beautiful camera. It's an SLR, which means I can interchange the lenses, and the lens I have mounted is already providing a wider view of my surroundings here. So hopefully this will mean better quality video and better sound since it's light years away from the old Canon camcorder I was using. I did play around with the camera this last weekend, got used to the settings and all that, so I think I'm finally confident to make a video. So hopefully this will go nice and smooth. Okay, well, what I have here for you is a build of the Jupiter 2, and this is not from the old 1960s series, but rather the series that ran on Netflix from 2018 to 2021. This was a reimagining or reboot of the show, and they redesigned everything, of course, including the Jupiter 2, and that's what I'm going to be working on. This project actually came about because it's going to be a gift from my friend Andrew Luolo, who is a subscriber who lent his talents to redesigning my logos here for the channel. He first redesigned the Interstellar Modeler logo, then moved on to providing one for the Interstellar Painter, and then one for, most recently, the Interstellar Academy. So thank you, Andrew, for all of that. And as we were talking, and I was mentioning I wanted to do something in appreciation for his efforts there, he mentioned he would love to have a model of the Jupiter 2 from the Netflix show, and I can definitely understand why. I'm a fan of the show as well. I really did enjoy it. So the model now is a 3D printed model. It can be found on cults3d.com. I'll go ahead and put the link down below. Now, the model was sized at 100% of what the files came as, and this then creates a model that's about 6.5 inches in length. And this is great because I'm going to be shipping this to Andrew. I didn't want to be too large, but you can, of course, certainly print it larger than this. The model has some really good details, including about 22 pieces in all. So I'm going to go ahead and show you the pieces I printed, and then we'll get started with the project. All right, let's go ahead and take a look at all the parts. We'll start off with the hull. It comes in two pieces. You can see they join together here. And so we do have a seam to work with, although I only need to address the areas here off to the sides. You'll notice there is a bit of a gap there. And this is something I do run across when I do have to print pieces that have flat surfaces that have to join this way. You would think that you'd want them flat against the build plate. However, printing that way is not always the best. In fact, I did try to see if I could get away with it, but I knew there were going to be some problems. And you can see right off the bat here, it's not as good of a print. You can see there are layer lines. In fact, between some of the layer lines, there's a gap there. But also what you end up with is a bit of excess resin along the edge where it rests against the build plate. That's called an elephant's foot. And you have to sand that away if you do decide to use pieces like this. There are settings you can adjust your printer to minimize that. I just haven't gotten around to that since I don't really print flat against the build plate that often. But you can see prints like that just don't come out as well. So I angled them this way, and this is how they came out instead. They say the best angle to print at is about 45 degrees. So you can see it's a much better print, but I do end up with these small gaps on each side. So if there's something that you are aware of that might minimize that when you have to print things like that, just let me know or leave a comment down below. I'd sure like to find out if you have any other suggestions there. All right, let's go ahead and move on to some of the other parts here. We've got a round piece that's going to fit along the top. There's a little opening here to fit into this key. And then on top of this is a detailing that's going to go there. And then we've got the bottom section here, which has this nice honeycomb pattern they've included. That's going to attach here. And then the rest of the pieces that you see there are just the trim that goes into all these recessed areas here. This is the trim that's going to be colored orange. We've got four engine bells that will fit all along here, the larger ones into these larger circles, and the smaller boosters into the smaller areas there. And then one other piece to show you is this little insert that will help add support as you join the pieces together. So what I'm going to do now is go ahead and glue these together, make sure everything's nice and secure, and to fill in those gaps, I'm going to use Milliput as I did with the Rising Star. All right, well, let me go ahead and jump ahead now and get you caught up on what I've done now. I've got the hull assembled, and you can see the seams have been covered with Milliput, which worked out great for that.
The pieces now have been primed with DupliColor's filler primer. It's just a light gray color. And I did reprint the bottom piece. This is the original piece now, and as I was test fitting it on here, I could tell it just wasn't going to fit flush up against it. There's pretty big gaps there, and that's simply because this side is irregular. As you can tell, I did trim down the keys, hoping that would help out a little bit, but even that wasn't enough. So I took the chance of reprinting it against the bill plate, and I know I just mentioned that you could have problems doing that, but this is a lower profile piece, so I did not get any of the layer lines that were so obvious with those other pieces I showed you. And remember I said that when you print against the bill plate, you have a little bit of excess resin that forms along the edge, and actually, it looks better this way than this way. It looks a bit more finished that way, so that worked out great. And I also used the slicer, since I was reprinting it, to just create an opening now for our mounting post, which is about 5 millimeters there in diameter. So this fits a lot better here against the hull. I'm not going to have any huge gaps there to have to deal with. The other thing I wanted to show you is the decal sheet that we created, and I say we because I reached out to Andrew to let him know I needed some decals designed, and I knew that he is quite skilled with working with different fonts and designing things like this, and so I sent him some screenshots of the Jupiter 2, and he was able to replicate the look of the font and also the symbol there he was able to capture and recreate here onto these decals. So I printed a bunch of them. Obviously, we're not going to use all these decals, but I went ahead and ran a bunch of them here. And you'll notice that I've got some black dots here off to the side. As I was printing this piece, I ended up reprinting the little buttons that I had lost. These buttons actually are supposed to go here and here. There's two that go on each side, and we have a few that go here, and I think a couple on the back. And at the time I was designing the decal sheet, I decided to include these because I wasn't sure how well these would print out again. The last ones I did, I lost before I really was able to inspect them closely. So I think I'm going to end up using these, however, instead of the decals. So I'm pleased with how things are moving along here. I'm going to move forward with attaching now the top and bottom sections there before we begin painting. Well, let me stop here for a minute just to share some screenshots with you here. There aren't a lot of reference photos of this ship that you can find online, so I decided to go back to the show and scroll through a number of the episodes so I can get some better screenshots of the ship, and I'm glad I did because I now have a bit more information to use here as reference. Let me go ahead and share some of these screenshots with you. First of all, the ship is white in color. That's what I'll be using then as a base color. But bear in mind now, we'll be using a gray wash as well, which will tone down that white a bit. I don't want it to look bright white. Another interesting point here is that circular piece on the bottom of the ship appears to be a heat shield. At least that's what it looks like to me. And here's a really good shot at it. First thing you can note right away is that it is painted a mid to dark gray. And the other thing you'll note is that the honeycomb pattern is a bit more intricate than the one is provided here with the files. But that's okay. I think what I can do here is do a paneling effect that might make that look a little more detailed. I'll just have to kind of experiment a little bit before doing that. The other thing you'll notice as you go through these screenshots, there are tiny little details that are missing on the model, such as these markings or details along the front and the back side here. But for some of these, I'll be using those little black dots I created for the decal sheet. And speaking of markings, there are a few other decals that I did not notice at first. There's this insignia or mission decal that you see here on the side of the ship. There's also a few markings like caution warnings and other numbers that are placed along the edge of the ship. And then there is the name Jupiter that you'll see on the aft section. So I've reached out to Andrew about these, and hopefully he'll be able to make us a few extra decals to account for those. So again, I'm glad I did that because now I have a bit more information to go by. And by the way, if you are interested in building this model and would like to have these reference shots, and the ones I showed you are just a few, I did take a bunch of them, I will have them uploaded into a Google Drive for Interstellar Modeler. Just email me and I'm more than happy to send them over to you. I like to make those types of things free to my subscribers, as well as, by the way, the decal sheet. Once I get that finalized, I'll have a JPEG and PDF on my drive as well. And again, just like to make those things available to you guys. All right, let's go ahead and move on.
So as you can see now, I've applied the base color, and for this I ended up using a can from Tamiya. This is their matte white color, and I decided to go this route versus an airbrush because white is one of these colors that can be pretty challenging to apply, and gosh, it sure takes a lot of coats out of an airbrush to cover something completely, and I just wanted to be able to apply paint, just a couple of coats and be done with it, and that's how it turned out. You can see I have the heat shield painted now, and this mottled appearance was achieved by making a paint mask. You can see I'm just cutting out some hexagons here, just freehand on a piece of paper, and I just taped that onto the heat shield and applied various shades of gray, turning that paint mask to a different orientation with each application of gray. So really what I wanted was to have multiple shades of gray on here and to make it look like some of the hexagons were darker than others, and I think it worked out pretty well. Not quite as exact, you know, I was cutting these freehand now, so some of these don't quite look like complete hexagons actually, but as you look at it this way, you can see there's a multiple shades of gray there, and that's really what I wanted. So let me show you a couple other things. First of all, this is the trim now, all painted orange. I used Mission Models orange with a drop of red, just to deepen that orange a little bit on its own. It's a little bit too yellow, so these are ready to go. I've applied a gloss coat to these as well, just to keep this free of any fingerprints as I'm handling them. And I also have the engines painted. For this, I used Mission Models high-speed silver, and just used flat black to darken up the middle there. The other thing I did was to fill in any gaps here along the edge, and I will do that also with the bottom piece. For that, I just used my plastic putty and the technique I always resort to, just filling in the seam and wiping it away with a wet Q-tip as I went along. All right, next step, adding on the trim. So moving on now to installing the pieces for the trim, and you can see, first of all, that I am not using super glue, but rather two-part epoxy. A couple reasons for this. First, it gives me more time to make sure that the piece is properly aligned prior to the adhesive hardening and curing. And although this takes a little bit more time to do, I think this will minimize the chance for mistakes. Secondly, and I'm not sure if any of you have experienced this, but I have found that superglue sometimes loses its hold over time, especially with this particular type of resin. I have found that sometimes I go back to look at a piece that I've completed, only to find that some of the parts have come undone. And I just haven't had that issue with two-part epoxy. So I'm just using a little masking tape along the edges here just to be sure that I don't smear the epoxy along places I don't want it to be. And once the piece is in place, I set a timer and hold it in place for a few minutes there while the epoxy hardens. Alright, well, definitely in the final stretches here now, and I applied a wash last night, as you can see here, and for this I am using Vallejo's gray wash rather than the black wash because the black would be too intense. And before doing this, I did spray on another gloss coat, and after it was applied, I just let this dry overnight, and this morning I wiped off the excess. And I think it did a good job with enhancing all the panel lines. This is what the top section looks like, of course, and here's the bottom. All right, so I applied another gloss coat on top of that, and this is where the food dehydrator is really helping out because it's been humid the last week here, and it sure helps to speed up the drying process and to give me confidence that everything is dry so I can proceed forward with the next step. Also painted in the windows, and for these lines here on each side, I just used the Tamiya panel accent color. You can see I'm just filling it in here. I applied a couple of coats of that. I did first start by applying the accent color to the windows. That way it would fill into the corners really well, and that way when I went over with a brush using the black paint, I didn't have to worry about getting into those tiny little corners there. And I want to show you the completed decal sheet now. So Andrew came through with designing these mission decals. Let me show you a close-up of those. And this is what he came up with. Looks just fantastic. And he also sent the name Jupiter in the same font as the rest, along with these S7 notations there that are placed on the upper side of the hull. And I also created more decals myself. I took the dots and expanded them so I had more of them. And also created this pattern here that will go on the back side just to stand in for those boosters that are there. And then we've got these double dots here that I've created that I'll be using along the hull as well. We've got these polygon decals here. These will be placed along the edge here and here. There's about 14 of them that I count that we need. these hash marks. We've got those that will be going along here and here, and then a couple others will go here and on the opposite side. And then this one here was created for the front of the ship right here. You'll see this is a picture of how they look on the ship. Now, one thing that I did come across was that this J2 here appears different in different scenes. So, for example, if you look at this shot, the 2 is just an outline of a 2. There's no color in it. And yet, in this episode, you'll see that 2 is filled in with orange. So, I actually did not notice that, but noticed that in that same shot, there was a J2 on the front, and the 2 was colored orange, which is why I filled this one in. But, again, if you look back at this other shot, you'll notice even that one does not have any color in it. So I'm going to go ahead and use the ones that I've made here that have no color in them, because you'll have to be consistent with these here. If I decided to use those, I'd have to create more decals with this. But since I have them all printed out here, I'm going to go ahead with what I have. So it looks like the decals were sized properly, and they are going on pretty easy. Just using Microset Solutions 1 and 2 for this. And of course using the reference pictures as a guide. Alright, I'm going to go ahead and complete this part of it. In the meantime, let me show you what I've done with the stand. What I'm using now here is an extra stand I happen to have from round 2. And I just went ahead and painted it matte black, and using this technique of just splattering some white paint to create a star field. Okay, here is now the completed stand. Along with the white, I ended up dotting in some blue, red, and green stars as well. And the post that the model is going to be mounted on is a brass post. And you can see there is a bend here, and that is on purpose. I actually had the post just straight up there when I mounted the model onto it. The model is front heavy, so it would just tilt to one side there. So that problem was solved by just adding in a bend. And when you mount the model now, it doesn't do that. Well, all I've got left now is to glue these engine bells on. So I'll show you the completed project next. Okay, so here we have the completed replica of the Jupiter 2 as seen in the 2018 Netflix series Lost in Space. This model measures about 6 inches in length and about 5.5 inches in width, and based on the size of the back door, I estimate this to be approximately 1/167th in scale. The files for this 3D printed model can be found on Cults 3D and Thingiverse, and were designed by DSK. He has a number of other designs on his page, including this one. Can you name the series? I'll tell you the answer at the end of the video. Well, getting back to our Jupiter 2, let's do a brief review of the build. The model was straightforward to print and to assemble, and I'm also happy to note that the designer did a great job with making sure all of the pieces fit well together, which isn't always the case. I began the model by first gluing the two halves together and concealing the main seam along the middle using Milliput, which worked well. This was followed by painting, which is pretty simple as the ship has only two colors, white and orange. If this were a larger kit, I probably would have taken the time to do some paneling, but even that is a feature that doesn't stand out when you see the ship on TV. I did, however, do some paneling on the heat shield, which I think added a nice touch. Once painting was done, an application of Vallejo's gray wash allowed for the enhancements of some of the panel lines and surface details. After the wash was completed, it was time to add on the decals, and I have to say, this project would not have been possible without the help of Andrew Luvolo, who I'm building the model for. He did a great job with designing decals that replicated the look of the font and was also able to recreate the logos and symbols. Along with his designs, I created some of my own in order to add in more markings and details. So a very big thank you goes to Andrew. So overall, it makes a very good replica of the ship, although this model reminds me a lot of the old Star Trek AMT kits because it resembles a ship, but there are a number of inaccuracies that become more obvious the closer you look. For example, if you look at the shape of the larger geometric design on the front edge of the ship, you can see that the shape differs when compared to what was seen on the show. Other differences include the shape of the areas around the cockpit and forward center section, and you can also tell that the circular section in the middle is shaped a bit different along the bottom and comes to more of a point at the top. There are a number of other things too, such as placement of windows and panel lines, and omission of various greeblies. But even I didn't notice all those shortcomings at first, and perhaps that's because I just really wasn't all that familiar with the ship. But when looking at the model, it's recognizable as the new version of the Jupiter 2. Again, just like the old AMT Enterprise and shuttlecraft kits. Well, I couldn't help putting the two versions of the Jupiter 2 together here, and they couldn't be more different, just as the shows couldn't be more different. The names of the characters are the same, and the concept of a family being lost in space is similar, but that is pretty much where the similarities end. Although I have a lot of nostalgia for the old show, I did feel that the new show was well written and produced, which is what made me a fan.
Well, even though I did spend that time there to point out all the little shortcomings of this model, it still makes a nice replica of the ship from the TV show, and it's unfortunately something that will probably never be commercially available, so having this is no doubt a nice addition to any sci-fi collection. Again, if you're interested in the files, they are available from cults3d.com or Thingiverse. I'll go ahead and place the link below, and they are for free. So, as usual, if you have any questions about anything I've done here, feel free to contact me here on my YouTube channel or interstellarmodeler@gmail.com. That is going to be a wrap for this project. Coming up on the channel now will be something for Halloween, as October is just around the corner. I will be participating in the HobbyLink International Boyd Crompton Halloween group build. That, of course, is in honor of Boyd, who passed away earlier this year. And if you want to know more about that, feel free to check out HobbyLink International's Facebook page for more details.
Oh, and as mentioned at the final reveal, this is another model by designer DSK, and is from a show called Timeless, if you didn't recognize it. It caught my eye because it's just not something that you see every day, but this thing was referred to as a lifeboat, and it's what the characters use to travel through time. This is a show I really enjoyed and got into, and it was on NBC from 2016 to 2018, so it was unfortunately short-lived. It was actually canceled after the first season, but was renewed at the last minute, then canceled again at the end of the second season, but apparently it was popular enough for the network to order a two-part finale to conclude the series, which I was happy to see.
And just another couple quick announcements I wanted to share with you. First, I'll be attending a model show called OrangeCon up in the Anaheim area. That's going to take place on October 6th, which I believe is a Sunday. So if you happen to be attending that show and you see me there, feel free to say hi. I'd be glad to meet you there. And then the other thing I wanted to share with you is I'm going to be making a trek out to Ticonderoga, New York. This is where the Star Trek Tours Museum is at. There's a gentleman named James Colley who produced a number of different fan films that are related to the original series, and in doing so, he made these wonderful sets that are recreations from the 1960s TV show. And they are faithful reproductions. He's gone to great lengths to make sure they are accurate. Any fan that I know has gone there has just raved about it, so it's become a pilgrimage for a lot of fans to make the trip out there, and I'm going to be making my trip finally here at the end of this month on September 28th is the day I'll be there. So definitely looking forward to that, and plan on creating a video at least to share the experience with you and fill you in on what is there. And, of course, I have a couple of Interstellar Academies that will be coming up pretty soon. If I need to find time to put those together, but that will be up on the channel very soon as well. All right, guys, thanks again for watching, and I'll see you in the next video. Take care.